Tenor sax of Stanley Turrentine with Jubilee Shout. Brother Tommy Turrentine will be up next on trumpet, Sonny Clark on piano, Kenny Burrell on guitar, Butch Warren on bass, and Al Harewood on drums. This is a title track of Turrentine's 1962 album, for Blue Note. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid. We had quite a response yesterday, and we could not accommodate all the calls. That's a good thing. It means that you're thinking. Hopefully, you're on point when you express your thoughts. That's always the wish. So we'll extend the hour from yesterday to today to accommodate all of the calls. Now, what were we talking about yesterday? We talked about the demand right now for answers from an incoming administration, since the soon-to-be former administration of Donald Trump has loused up the works magnificently. To accommodate callers, we are going to extend the discussion to today, make it a part two. And here's what we'll be talking about. As you are going to be a strategic advisor to President-elect Joe Biden, and as a strategic advisor to President-elect Joe Biden, what will be on the list of the nation's most critically urgent priorities that he and his administration should be tackling as of day one? You are the advisor. You're calling the shots. You are deciding. Well, of course, he's free to tell you, just get out of here with that. But at the same time, that's what advisors do, especially their trusted advisors, seasoned advisors, people who have been paying attention. It isn't just what you must do, but what you must do in a manner that cements your relationship with the people. In other words, what is going to be the motivating factor behind whatever is recommended? What are the benefits of getting it done? You have to explain why your suggestion Why is your suggestion one of the most urgent suggestions that the president must consider? What are the workable solutions that can be implemented immediately? Not tomorrow, not after a series of meetings, but right now. And you know right now you're out of time. No more meetings for right now. Now is the time for action. What should the incoming president be prepared to do as of day one to address the urgent priorities that are confronting his administration? The number to call is 888-874-4888, 888-874-4888. I want you to be as succinct as you possibly can, but targeted in what it is you're saying, and please do make some sense. Again, we know you're not an advisor to the president in real life. But in a sense, everybody should be prepared to be an advisor to the president, especially considering the urgencies that we have been confronting in recent years. So I want you to be straightforward. This is what I will advise the president to do right now to begin to let us start these projects right now. But I only need you to identify one that you consider the most urgent or among those at the top of the list of urgencies that this administration should address. 888-874-4888. We start with Patricia from New York. Hello, Patricia.
Good afternoon, you, Teresa, and good afternoon to the PRN family.
Thank you. Good afternoon to you.
I want you to know that this is something that I have been thinking about, and I actually intend to send this suggestion to the Congressional Black Caucus. Joe Biden's connection to the 1994 crime bill, my recommendation to him would be to immediately undo the consequences of mandatory minimum sentences, especially for low-level drug offenses. And so he could certainly sign an executive order immediately to clear the felony records of all of those black men whose felony records are like a noose around their neck because they are unable to get jobs. They can't get public housing. They can't even live in public housing with their family. And he has indicated that he would set aside monies to enhance the police department. And I would say that rather than enhance the funding to the police, that he should take that money and provide funding for education and job training specifically targeted to these men who were incarcerated because of minimum mandatory sentences.
What is the benefit of doing this to the president? Remember, everything has a benefit. What is the benefit to Biden?
Well, the benefit is that, first of all, he was on life support. I mean, his heart had stopped beating until the black community came to his rescue in the primary. Now, 80% of black men voted for him. And unfortunately, those other 20%, you know, he might want to consider getting them on his side. So the benefit to him would be to, number one, to show gratitude and appreciation to the community that put you in office. But number two, to say to those black men, okay, maybe there were unintended consequences, but this is what I can do to begin to make you whole. I can't make you completely whole, but maybe I can make you half whole. So the benefit to him would be to say thank you to the black community and say to those men whose lives were disrupted, not only the men's lives who were disrupted, but the families of those men whose lives were disrupted, that he would like to atone for that. Show some gratitude and appreciation.
In this world of politics, is this a good time to do something like this?
There is always a good time to say thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you, Patricia, for getting us started today. You will recommend immediately to the president that he revise the crime bill by executive order and put people back on track, put their lives back on track, and start there. Okay. Thank you. Gino from the Bronx, you're on the air.
Sister Utrice, it's been a while.
Yes, it has.
I say good day to you and the audience because the good news is we all woke up today.
Good move. Thank you. Now, have you to say about your role in your newly
Here we go.
Appointed role as senior advisor to the president? What will you be advising the president to do and to do now?
Mr. President, once you put your hand on that Bible, I'm going to suggest you be wearing a sackcloth and put some ashes on your head. Because the immoral wars that cost millions of lives that you were involved with the 22,000 children dying every day from no food because they have no oil under their feet, so we don't pay attention to them, I suggest you declare a day for yourself and the country of fasting. And no eating.
Gino, you have to take this seriously.
I am being very serious.
Pontificate. We're trying to get to what people are saying as a practical suggestion to address the issues that we have now. This is not the time to go esoteric.
I'm being very practical, Yatrice, because more people would die from the children starving and people dying from heart disease and cancer every year than COVID.
The president doesn't know more people will die and their children will be starving.
Well,
obviously
he needs to repent.
Do you have an assessor? Do you have a suggestion that could be put into place right now that would help people other than that the president should wear sackcloth and ashes?
I think that would make a statement to the world that he's serious about repenting.
Thank you so much.
I have other ones.
No, you're done. We have to move on. Let's leave from Manhattan. You're on the air.
Hello. Good afternoon
to
the PRN audience.
Thank you. And same to you.
Thank you. I would like everyone to get out a pencil and paper because what I'm about to tell you is going to blow your mind. President-elect Biden should use the National Defense Directive Law to create a master plan to provide far UVC lights in all public places. The experts speak about far UVC light and its use on YouTube, and it will destroy viruses in the air and on surfaces and allow all of us to get back out into public life. Now, on YouTube, there are several experts that speak about this. Dr. David Brenner is a physics expert at Columbia University, and Fred Maxick, an expert on ultraviolet light and COVID-19.
So tell me, Madam Advisor, put it in a sentence. Let me hear it clearly.
You mean you want one sentence explanation?
Your suggestion. If you can boil it down to one sentence that could stick in my mind.
The public utilization of ultraviolet light called far UVC can destroy viruses in the air and on surfaces without harming humans and allow us all to get back to public life without masks.
Okay, how does this relieve the situation right now? Because that would involve a lot of work, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would involve work and expenses to create these ultraviolet lights. I mean, they've already been created, but if he put in the National Defense Directive, I believe that's what it's called, he could have all the factories in the country that are capable of making these lights and putting them in public schools, airports, bus terminals, subways, supermarkets, all public venues. So we all would not be confined to our homes because we're afraid of spreading the virus.
But something like that also makes people uneasy because they don't know about the efficacy of these ultraviolet lights.
Well, the experts would be on the panel with President Biden, Dr. David Brenner of Columbia University, who's a physics expert, and he has done research on what's called far ultraviolet C lights that will prevent the virus from being spread in public. The other expert is Fred Maxick, and his company creates UV lights. So, but you don't like me to mention any company names because you say that I was promoting products. But this is a product that would do everybody a world of good, and we don't have to be confined to our homes anymore.
But it is an idea. But it has to go through a lot of testing first.
Been tested, and it's in the PubMed Central file. So you can go to the PubMed Central file, look up far UVC lights for COVID-19, and the several articles will pop up.
Thank you so much. G from Manhattan, you're on the air. What will you, as the advisor, the senior advisor to Joe Biden, the incoming president, what will you advise as top priority items that he needs to start on and to, in fact, get started right now?
I would say he should take a health approach to the COVID situation, and he could use the National Defense Authorization Act to get the companies that are producing drugs to produce vitamin C for everyone, for example, vitamin C, vitamin D, and liquid minerals for the people to take. And it would be produced at no cost to the public so that people who can't afford these things would be able to get it. A lot of people now, I've been asking, are taking vitamin C, they're taking the D, they're taking all these supplements to help strengthen the immune system. So I would say to the president, what we need to do while you're looking for a viable drug, and while you're getting all these doctors and immunologists and all these people to look at COVID, I would say take a look at the states that are getting the highest numbers right now and see why they're doing it. See if it really is the masks, not wearing masks. And if they're not wearing masks and that's what really would help people, then I would say we would have to mount an approach to get people to wear masks and to do the social distancing. He would have to put himself, I would just say, he would have to put himself as a healthy person up as someone who's exercising, someone who's taking the supplements himself, and someone who's trying to do the right things himself to not have COVID. But he could use the act to have companies produce the vitamins and the supplements at no cost to the public and have it distributed.
But can he realistically do that? Would the law allow him to do that?
Okay, well, I haven't checked specifically, but if the president can produce masks and the previous one could have used the National Defense Authorization Act to produce masks and other PPE, and he didn't use it, then I don't see why this president coming in could take a health approach and try to build up the immune systems of people and have the supplements produced at no cost.
Yes, but when you start distributing medications or drugs or vitamins or whatever it is you want to call them to supposedly boost people's immune systems, you cross the line into a whole new world.
The okay.
President then is prescribing medications to, in the interest of helping them become more resistant to infection. That's not the president's job.
Okay, well, I see your point there. I would say to that then that while he is having his doctors look at COVID, I would also say the public health people would also be involved in his panel. And many of them, I mean, I listened to Gary Noe, and he promotes, and he's not the only one, is promoting vitamin C. Now, I wouldn't say
that's
a
whole different thing.
I wouldn't say
I'm talking about as a government, can a government undertake something like that? I seriously doubt it.
Mm.
Only because the government's job is to, first of all, they have to move quickly. Secondly, there are all these requirements to prove the efficiency and the efficacy of distributing these drugs. Number three, the government should not be in charge of distributing medications or supplements or anything of that sort to people. They should not be involved in that. Good idea.
So then I would have to find something else. I mean, there has to be something that could be given because people can buy it over the counter. Perhaps this can
so
be made
them
as a
encourage them to buy it. Encourage them to take it. But
okay.
You can't involve the government in distributing any kind of medication. You just can't.
All right, so then I would take that as an instruction, and I would just say that we have to encourage people to buy it and to take it, and still the president
I'm not for encouraging people to do anything that has to do with medications. I don't tell people what medications to take, because if some person should react violently against anything that you recommend, are you willing to sign a piece of paper saying that you agree to be sued? You agreed to pay the cost of any damages suffered by anybody.
Okay, well, we can have the doctors. Perhaps we could say, see your doctor.
No, you see, it's already too complicated. This is a personal decision. And you have to leave it to people to decide whether this is something they want to do. But we certainly wouldn't be comfortable promoting that the government do it, no matter how benign it sounds. This is a very litigious society, and all of a sudden you may find people reacting, quote, negatively, or the medication having adverse effect on people.
Okay.
And they're in court asking for compensation. And that's why we stay away from that kind of thing.
I respect that. But then that makes me ask this question. If they're going to come out with a vaccine, won't we also have those same issues that you're bringing up? I'm not trying to argue with you. I'm just saying.
No. I understand your question. It's a very good question. They have a certain leeway in that it is recognized globally that there is a pandemic, there's a disease that has spread all over the world. In the case of the United States alone, we have had just this past weekend, the numbers are terrible, 250,000 deaths as of this morning.
Right.
And we have a weekly average now of 821 deaths going all the way up to 1,167 deaths. So this is a really serious situation. In the situation where you have the spread of a disease, and there is no cure yet, governments might be given permission to even use experimental drugs, but certainly to use those drugs that experts have examined and studied over a period of time and have gathered the evidence to back up their assertions, that we can try this, as Pfizer, for example, has come out with a statement saying that the drugs have been found to be very, I mean, they're not perfect yet, but they, at 90-plus efficiency, they would recommend that it be used now. The country and the world is in a state of emergency around coronavirus. So they have a little bit of leeway there. The international community, medical community, is also saying, given where we are now, given the state of affairs, we can suggest the use of it until something better comes along, but we have nothing. And these are not drugs that, you know, they just snapped up. These are drugs that have gone through trials. They have come up with certain outcomes that are encouraging. And they're suggesting it's much, much better than doing absolutely nothing.
Well, I would say we have to be very careful, because it seems...
Of course, have to be very careful. But at the same time, this is your position. You are recommending to the president as a senior advisor, and you have to have some kind of grounds for saying what you say. And I'm asking you, are you comfortable with what you say?
Comfortable with recommending, actually, my full suggestion would have been to have not just me, but the public health people, also the naturopathic doctor people, also to recommend, and to specifically recommend what the dosage would be. Those would be the details, how it would be distributed, and if it can be, or if it can only be recommended, how will we recommend the vitamin C? How will we recommend it? Perhaps all we can do is just recommend strongly that you take
those precautions. Well, that has to be determined by that particular community, and you are the advisor. I mean, in real life, the advisor, but you're playing the role of an advisor, which means by the time you put something on the table for consideration, you ought to have a good defense for it.
Well, my defense would be that it is in use in the population already.
That's not a defense.
Who are getting it. Okay. Well, that would be my defense. And that there are public health people
that
are
using it is not a defense.
But also public health people are using this, and they are recommending it. I'm not saying that
they're not medical experts. Okay. You realize what the enormity of the impact that you're talking about here. If something, one group of people somehow are reacting adversely, you got a problem. So there are protocols to be followed, and you can't just decide, well, we'll try it out on people who are willing to try it and see what the results are. No, well, it has to go through a pretty rigorous test.
I'll take your point, but I would just say that I hope we're using that same method of caution for the vaccine, and I realize the vaccines
sure
is not something that I'm recommending right now, because it sounds like it takes at least 2 years to come up with a vaccine. And
all right, but we're not debating that
you
right
know,
now.
But I'm,
I
I'm
understand
not,
your point.
I'm giving,
but it's not about whether you're recommending it or not recommending it. What we are interested in right now, with you as our stand-in advisor to the president, what you are going to demand that the president do right now?
I would say he would be an example of healthy eating, healthy living to strengthen the body. And he would say, look, we have to take care of our bodies. See your doctor as much as you can to get the best recommendations of what you should do to keep yourself strong. And please wear a mask. Please socially distance. And if you can take
the vaccine, you're encouraging the president to be an example of good health and good health practices.
Good
All
health
right.
Practices
well, thank you for
vaccine.
That. Thanks very much.
Okay. Thank you.
888-874-4888. Ed from Jamaica, you're on the air.
Hello, Yatrice. How you doing?
Okay. How's by you?
Well, you know, me and my thumbs, we're still here.
That's
on.
Good. Nothing has fallen off yet. That's good.
It's all we can do sometimes. Speaking from the aspect of an advisor, basically the concrete thing we got to do, we got to address this COVID-19 situation and we got to address the economic situation. So twofold. First of all, Mr. Biden, get your pen out, because we're going to blitz him with executive orders. We're going to executive order at least $1,200 worth of recovery checks for the next 4 months. We're going to give every 2 weeks, we're going to give a large portion of the American public $1,200 right off the top. Number two, we're going to implement a healthy living plan. Yes, we're still going to work on the virus, but we're still going to work on the vaccine. We're also going to implement healthy living, exercise, getting up, working out, trying to increase your immune system. We're going to ensure those who are most vulnerable, i.e. the elderly and the ethnic communities. We're going to institute mass units. So it's going to be a whole lot of executive orders. A whole lot of money is going to come flowing out of the government. We got it. We can take it from defense initiative. We can use it as a defense initiative, because the health of a nation directly correlates to a nation's defense. A weak nation can't defend itself. A sick nation can't defend itself. So that would be my suggestion. Executive orders, money into the economy, money to small businesses, money and also increase the open enrollment part of the Affordable Care Act. Extend that under executive order. So allow everybody to get to a doctor that wants to get to a doctor. And we can put that in a package and run it right, and then we just executive order it. Forget about Congress. Forget about the Senate. We use the bully pulpit, and we hammer it in.
Okay. Now, if everybody was listening, that would be an exciting example. Ed would be an exciting example of how we ought to tackle this exercise that we're doing. So $1,200 for the next 4 months. Why 4 months?
Well, I think 4 months is a good, I'm not saying that would be the end, but I'm saying 4 months, $1,200 every 2 weeks, that would be enough to get people on a stable footing and would give them the confidence that they made the right choice in their vote. It would help stimulate the economy. It would help pay some mortgages. It would help pay some rent. It would put some food on the table. It's a concrete action that we can say, hey, you put me in office, this is what I'm going to do for you right now. I'm going to put some money in your pocket. I'm a practical person. I believe in X's and O's, and I believe in concrete solutions. So I want to see something right away. Bam. It's $1,200. You know you're guaranteed it for the next 4 months. Rock with that. Then we can move on. Once we've established that, once we've got that calm, when you can pay your bills, you feel good. You know, I mean, when you know that you got a place to rest your head, you feel good. When you know you can pay the mortgage, you know you keep the lights on, when you know you keep the heat on, you feel good. And then we can move from there. Stimulate small business. And open up the open enrollment for the affordable care. Open it up to everybody. Anybody who wants to see a doctor, see a doctor. You can go to the hospital, no charge. But I'm talking about, you know, the precursor to government-funded free health care. And we can executive order this stuff, and we can ride that wave onto a brighter future.
What is the incentive, other than you become healthier, under the healthy living plan? What is the incentive there?
Well, we have a problem in this country with obesity. We have a problem in this country with bad health, specifically in the minority communities, especially because of the low income and the lack of good food, the lack of fresh air, clean water. I mean, in certain countries, if you look around the globe, if you look at Africa, they've done a remarkable job in handling the COVID-19 situation because it's a healthier population. It's a younger population. So we got to concentrate on this. These are some short, long-term goals that we can focus on. Once we address the immediate concerns of economy, of immediate health care, of immediate employment by stimulating the economy, then we can look at the long term. You know, exercise, feel better. You know, that can improve your mental state. Exercise can lift your mental state. It's lift my mental state on occasion. It can improve your awareness, and it makes you more accustomed to being healthy. And we can institute that as a long term goal. But initially, let's start getting people out of doldrums. Let's get our minds off of the nightmare that was 2020. Let's get our minds off of the nightmare that was Donald Trump. Let's put something out there to feed the people. To feed the people. We're going to feed the people pocketbook. We're going to feed the people stomach. We're going to feed the people psyche. Let's get out of the darkness. Start walking towards the light.
Well, thank you, Mr. Advisor. Thank you very much for your advice. I think you're on the mark with your suggestions. Thank you. Ali from New York, you're on the air.
Hi, Trish. How are you doing? Good afternoon to you and to the listening audience.
Good afternoon to you. How are you?
And I'm the male. I'm the female holding by my thumb, too.
You're hanging by your thumbs, too.
Yes. Well, and I just want to say to the president, thank you for giving me one of the dream job, even though I didn't vote for you, but I really appreciate the job that you're giving me right now. So my recommendation to you, Mr. President, will
be... You're welcome for the advisor job. Thank you.
Yes. And my recommendation to him is to have an executive order, to sign an executive order to save the post office. I believe that he should right away give the money that the post office is in need right now. And I believe it's about $25 million. And one of the major things that I would tell him right now is without those mail ballots, you would have never won those key states that he needed to win. And one of them is Pennsylvania. So I think it's important to save the post office because during the quarantine, one of the group that you always saw outside, especially in my neighborhood, were the United Postal Service. They never stopped delivering the mail. So I think it's very important also because a lot of the seniors, a lot of people, they do get the medication through the Postal Service, through the United States Postal Service. As a matter of fact, I got my vitamins about two days ago delivered to my door by a mailman. So also it would be a good thing to give thanks to the people of color, especially to African Americans, that is a big group that works in the post office, in the United States Postal Service. As you know, Mr. President, you won this election because a lot of the people of color, especially African American, went and gave you the vote. So this is one way that you could give thanks to those people that voted for you. And also for those mail-in ballots, you would have never won this election. And if you're still around for the next election, maybe the post office will be in very good shape and you will win your second term through mail-in ballots again. So I think it's important, and you could also push for the creation of the public bans coming from the Postal Service. So that would be my advice to the president.
Okay. By the way, thank you very much, Madam Advisor. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
874-4888. I'm thinking we'll take a little break here, although we're late for our break, or unless I see calls coming in and I can take them right away at 888-874-4888. The whole point here is to readjust our thinking. We leave the decision making up to other people, and then our job, we think, is to react. No, we can do our own thinking too. In this situation, what would we suggest that the president, the incoming president, do, and why? Why would a savvy president do these things that are being suggested? Of course, you have reasons for that as well, and that's good. So I'm happy to know that you're thinking and that you can see the connection. You know, it's not just, well, there's an election. No, Ali just connected for us. And before her, we had Ed from Jamaica do similar connections to show that there is a cause and effect. Nothing happens in a vacuum. And the more we internalize that, we take our thinking to a whole other level, because we know that there is a reaction to every action. And if we want a reaction to be a certain thing, we should know what, or we can tell from in advance what our action needs to be to encourage that kind of reaction. So this is good. So let's use our time to benefit that kind of thinking, and use our time efficiently to just indulge publicly so people get used to the idea of being a presidential advisor. That's what voters are, technically. You cast your vote to reflect your thinking and to encourage a certain action on the part of the person you're voting for. So it is not disconnected at all. This is what we have to do to, again, just add more and more skills to our skill set, because we get over this hump of just doing things because, well, we're doing things. No, there's purpose, there's thought behind it, and obviously you will be monitoring to see what the impact has been of your actions and your thoughts. Okay, 888-874-4888. We've had some pretty interesting developments as well in the last couple of days by the president and the outgoing president, hopefully, the soon-to-be outgoing president, and even Republicans now. More and more Republicans are getting concerned about the president's actions and the likely impact of those actions. They're watching, but interestingly, nobody is raising, publicly at least, they're not raising questions about what we've been talking about for the last 4 years, and that is his mental acuity. What is going on with this man? He has drawn down the troops in the Middle East. We don't know what the impact is. We don't know who he consulted. We don't know anything like that. He just decided he is the president. He could do whatever he wants. But there are consequences to actions. And we see that in his rush to install himself in perpetuity in the minds of Americans, he's likely to do anything. So we have to watch that with a keen eye. Let me see if I have any. Oh, we have some vacancies here. You can call now and get on the air, or we just move on. 888-874-4888 is the number to call. 888-874-4888. When we talk about this new president coming in, we know that there's a big fight going on behind closed doors. This president has been obstructed. He's been delayed in putting plans together. So a lot of things will be off to a late start or maybe scuttled completely because Donald Trump would have frustrated the whole idea of starting things on time when there was, in fact, was time. He's being an obstructionist. He is doing things that people haven't seen in their entire lives done in the United States. They've never seen a process, an electoral process, so completely targeted for chaos. But we will see. We will see. Okay, Jay from New York, you're on the air.
To the listener audience. I was listening to Ed earlier this week about giving the American public $1,200 for 4 months. I mean, the reality is that's just not enough. I mean, it would help the economy.
We're not doing regular programming. If you have a suggestion as an advisor to the president in that role, in that capacity, what is your suggestion?
My suggestion is that there should be a forgiveness of student loans based upon the amount that is.
That's already on the table.
Oh well, I'm looking at everything economically. I think it should be some sort of rent forbearance in regards to those that are under a certain income. I think that there should be some sort of job training programs in regards to STEM to help boost the economy. I mean, there has to be some sort of improvement with infrastructure in the country. There has to be some sort of reform to the criminal justice system. I mean,
You are aware that the charge here for the advisor is to recommend things that can be done right now.
If that's the case, I think that most things can't be done because of the way that the system is set up in regards to if they don't gain control of the Senate. So any recommendation that is being made is in all honesty something that's going to be fought for and that more than likely will not happen. You can see that what's going on with the whole stimulus right now. So, I mean, we're in a situation to where, as if to be truthful, I don't see how the country is going to move forward unless it's for the benefit of big business. So if you think
Then we'll have to deal with you and your suggestions at another time because you're telling us what is not possible. We're looking
If one was to say what is possible, the question becomes, what is it? I don't see anything that's practically possible to happen other than maybe trying to get people to wear their masks and, you know, if possible, maybe quarantine for a month to be able to shut down non-essential businesses to try to get the pandemic under control because of the increased deaths in the country. But that may even be a problem because of the sycophant fans of Donald Trump. So, I mean, it's just going to be real interesting.
All right. Thank you for your call. Harvey from Brooklyn, from Berkeley, sorry, you're on the air.
Hello? I hear music. Hi.
I can hear you.
Okay. Well, in my mind, the first thing that should be done is economic relief to help the people, the middle-class people and people of low income. Because here's some headlines. 30 to 40 million people in America could be evicted from their homes by the end of 2020 without swift, significant federal intervention. They need about $100 billion in emergency rental assistance to stop this mass eviction. You know, they talk about homeless people. You're going to talk about millions and millions of people who are homeless and are going to be struggling to make ends meet to get from day to day. Here's another one: millions of Americans are
not hearing you anymore.
I don't know what's happening. Hello.
Okay, no. Now I can hear you.
Okay. It says that millions of Americans are at risk of losing power and water because of unpaid utility bills. 179 million people who are at risk of shutoff of many of their utilities. So,
as an advisor to the president, what will your suggestion be? What will be your directive for the president?
Well, the suggestion would be to immediately fund a lot of the problems here that are going to come down. Here's another one: over 25 million Americans are at risk of losing their health care as the coronavirus rages. So they'll lose their house, they'll lose their utilities, they'll lose their health care. And the last one is up to 15 million Americans will be devastated by the loss of pandemic stimulus the day after Christmas. I hate to say it, but this is once again economic vulturism, because when we had the housing crisis years back, the venture capitalists stepped in, and for pennies on the dollar, they bought an unbelievable amount of homes, which they rented back to the people who owned them originally. So this may be, by not giving the people the stimulus package they need, they're putting us all in the hands of the venture capitalists and also the prisons for profit. If people don't have money to eat and feed their families, they will commit crimes and be vulnerable to be harvested for the prisons for profit, as well as have no choice but to go.
Make the suggestion. What is your suggestion to the president? Something he can do right now.
To as soon as possible make funds available to assist these middle and low income Americans who, by no fault of their own, are in jeopardy of severe loss. And it'll be like an unbelievable tragedy to America. And that's what I, before the jobs, it's to make funds available to help these people. It's like World War II. They pull out all the stops and they fund the troops. And so the Americans of low income are the troops, are economic troops, and they need funding immediately on every level to save them and put them in out of harm's way during the coronavirus.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
And with And with that, we come to the end of our program today. You may not be aware of it, but just from these suggestions today, we have pretty cogent suggestions that the president should be aware of or be made aware of, that people are saying, this is what could happen. This is what you ought to do. These are top priorities as we see them. And it would be good if you can get to these somehow soon, because the situation is as urgent as the coronavirus situation. So I think this is a very good exercise. We are beginning to think a little bit beyond our geographic boundaries, and we're seeing things systemically that need to be resolved ASAP. This is where the trouble really starts exploding, from the bottom up. It's not from the top down. It's from the bottom up. We have to really start looking at our society that way. What is happening at the bottom, and in terms of how people are living, what they're coping with, the challenges that they're coping with every single day, and what we can do to assist in advocating for them. And the best way to do that is we talk, we bring this to light among ourselves, but certainly among people who have even greater access to, you know, the power systems in this country. And we need to start ramping that up to let people know that we are watching. And if they have something in mind, consider this, you know, and you state your case. But don't overwhelm. Pick one thing or two things, and that's it. And then you can do it again. But don't overwhelm people with your ideas. This is a time to be very precise and let them know that you will be watching them. This is something new. I'm so grateful and thankful, and I appreciate the effort being made to be as useful as possible when we are together. Thank you so much, and we'll talk again tomorrow. Bye-bye.